Michael, yes. You're going to do that? Okay.
I'm going to introduce the song. Okay, so this next song is in the traditional parts of Haggadah, it's 7 here. And it's called Vehisha Anda. We all know it. And today we're going to do a special rendition of it with all the kids. So guys, remember to sing nice and project, because today they have the choir, and it's going to be beautiful. So the English translation of this song is, and this is the promise which sustained our fathers and us, and this is from the Haggadah, that it is not one enemy alone that stood up against us to destroy us, but that in each generation there are those standing up against us to destroy us. But the Holy One, blessed be He, saved us from their hand. Amen. So, Lord, we thank You for Your salvation for us in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
Oh, Kadosh Baruch Hu Matzilenu, Matzilenu, Miyadara. Kadosh Baruch Hu Matzilenu, Matzilenu, Miyadara.
Kadosh, everyone.
Kadosh Baruch Hu Matzilenu, Matzilenu, Miyadam. Kadosh Baruch Hu Matzilenu, Matzilenu,
everybody. You may be seated. Okay, wow, that was very special. Thank you, kids, and thank you, older kids. Amen. You know, at this time of Passover, as we partook of the Afikoman, I was reminded of the passage regarding not eating and drinking in an unworthy manner. Remember the third cup, the cup of salvation, and the Afikoman, which Yeshua said represents his body. And there was a warning there, don't drink it unworthy, prepare yourself. And so it said that each one must examine himself before he eats. In the same way, we ought to examine ourselves before we bring the tithe. And you know, the examining passage here is not from the book of Corinthians, but it's from Malachi 3. And I think we are all familiar with that passage, right? It says, bring in the whole tithe and the cup will overflow and I'll pour out blessings on you. But there's a verse that comes before that that says that you rob me. And then the people of Israel say to God, how have we robbed you? And he said, with your tithes and offerings. So today I feel a little bit like the prophet Jeremiah who says something that's not so easy to say. And I'm not speaking to everyone here. I'm speaking to you. And if you are convicted by this, may God do a work in our hearts. If we bring our tithes in a sloppy and an incomplete way, it places us under God's curse. That's what the scriptures say. It says you are under a curse because you don't bring in the whole tithe because you rob us. And God says that if he tells a watchman to warn people and he doesn't, then their blood is on him. So today, because I'm taking up the tithe, I really felt a strong sense in my heart to bring this verse to some of us. Why willingly put yourself under the curse if God has redeemed us from the curse, right? We as believers are redeemed. And so we are entitled to live under God's blessing. And his blessing flows when we give him the fullness of our tithes. You know, it is one of the few passages in the scriptures that actually invites us to test God. He says, test me. If you bring in the full tithe, I will provide for all your needs. And so today, if you are struggling with bringing in the full tithe, I want to encourage you. God is able to provide for you. Determine in your heart to bring in the full tithe so that you can be under the blessing of God. You know, if we have repentance in our heart, it takes us out of the curse from God and brings us into his blessing. And you know what? Just as he did the impossible for the people of Israel during Passover when he led us through the Sea of Reeds, he can do the impossible for our lives. If you think your budget can't balance if you bring your tithe, I promise you, God can part the Red Sea for you. He can make your budget balance. Trust him in it, test him in it, and bring in the full tithe. So, Lord, we want to thank you for your word. And, Lord, your word does have that warning for us that we should not rob you lest we are coming under a curse. And I ask you, Father, that you'll bless each one here. Bless those who are bringing the full tithe. Lord, pour out overflowing blessings on them. And, Lord, I pray that you'll help each one who is struggling to bring the full tithe to you. Lord, thank you for faith to arise. Thank you for your provisions. We praise you for it, and we worship you in the name of Yeshua. Amen. So I'm sorry for the hard word today, but that was what was on my heart. And if you are a visitor, please fill in the blue and white Shalom cards on or next to your seat, and you can drop it in the offering basket, and we'll keep you updated. And you can also give online or via debit and credit in the back, and obviously cash and checks. So as we take up the offering, we want to sing another special song, which is called Katonti, and it talks about that Jacob passed over the river as one, and then God divided him and multiplied him. So this is also a Passover song of thankfulness, and we're going to sing it together.
מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך. קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך. קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך. קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך.
כי במפלי עברתי את הירדן, אתה היית לי שני מחנות. הצילני נא, הצילני נא, הצילני נא. כי במפלי עברתי את הירדן, אתה היית לי שני מחנות. הצילני נא, הצילני נא, הצילני נא.
קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך. קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת אשר עשית את עבדך.
כי במקרי עברתי את הירדן, אתה הייתי לשני מחנות. הצילני נא, הצילני נא, הצילני נא. כי במקרי עברתי את הירדן, אתה הייתי לשני מחנות. הצילני נא, הצילני נא, הצילני נא. כי חסדך גדול עליי, כי חסדך גדול עליי.
Oh, 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 oh,
למקלי עברתי את הירדן, אתה איתי לשני מחנות. הצילי נא, הצילי נא, הצילי נא. כי במקלי עברתי את הירדן, אתה איתי לשני מחנות. הצילי נא, הצילי נא, הצילי נא.
קטונתי מכל החסדים ומכל האמת, האמת.
אמן. You may be seated.
Testing. Okay. Wow, beautiful song. The children should be in their service right now, so we're going to dismiss the children. Juniors in the back and seniors in the front. I understand there's a dance instructional for the Shabbat school. Are they all in the front? Okay. All right. Great to see everyone. Shabbat Shalom. Again, this is our Passover service. Great to have you here with us, and as I mentioned earlier, we are lingering in the presence after the service all the way to midnight. Well, not quite, but all right, I'll give everyone a moment to have a seat. All right. Many of us know who C.S. Lewis is. He's a famous believer and author and thinker. And he once said this, that true humility is not thinking less of ourselves, but rather it is thinking of ourselves less. Right? Thinking of ourselves less. Now, this is a great challenge in a world that is obsessed with self. We're living in a world that's all about me. We're obsessed with ourselves. Our fallen nature is obsessed with itself. I came across an illustration that shows how sad this really is. This writer says, I watched a movie once where several men were left drifting aimlessly on the ocean in a small lifeboat. After a terrible shipwreck, the sun was hot and their rations were low, and soon they ran out of fresh water. One night, while the others were sleeping, one man drank from the ocean. Ocean water contains 7 times more salt than the human body can safely ingest, and he soon died. The saddest part is that the more salt water a person drinks, the thirstier they become. Preoccupation with self is just like that. It is to drift aimlessly with an unquenchable thirst, ending in eternal death. The more we focus on ourselves, the more we desire to satisfy and indulge ourselves. It's a never-ending, increasing circle of darkness. And one of the strongest natural instincts is that of self-preservation. But is safety, protection, and self-preservation the ultimate goal of our lives? Is it all about saving ourselves, safety, preservation? I want us to look today at a time that Yeshua was challenged to save himself. They challenged him, save yourself. Was that his ultimate goal? And I'm talking about the hours that Yeshua hung on the tree of sacrifice. As we know, he had been turned over to Pontius Pilate, who examined him and said, I find no reason for death in him. Yet because of the murmuring crowds, he caved in, had Yeshua scourged, and then taken to be crucified. And I want us to look at Matthew chapter 27, verses 37 to 44. Matthew 27, verse 37. And they put up over his head the accusation written against him. Zehu Yeshua, Melech HaYehudim. This is Yeshua, the King of the Jews. Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right hand and another on the left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging the head, and saying, You who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. There it is. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise, the chief priests, also mocking with the scribes and elders, said, He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him. Now, if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God. And even the robbers who were crucified with him reviled him with the same thing. Wow. They cried out to him and they said, Save yourself now, hotshot. That's basically the tone that they were using. If you really are who you say you are, come on down from the cross. He saved others, but look, he can't even save himself. He says he trusts in God. Well, let God now deliver him. If he really is the Son of God, Israel's king, let him come down now and we will believe in him. These were the challenges and the taunts that he endured while hanging on that tree of sacrifice. Now, the first question to ask in kind of reflecting on this is, first of all, could he have saved himself? Could he have saved himself? Yeshua answered that question in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before when they came to arrest him. I want us to look at what he said in Matthew 26, just a few hours before when he was arrested, Matthew 26. Verse 50, and Yeshua said to Judas, who had betrayed him, Friend, why have you come? Then they came and laid hands on Yeshua and took him. And suddenly one of those who were with Yeshua stretched out his hand, and we know that was Peter, impetuous Peter. He stretched out his hand, drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear. And Yeshua said, Put away your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Now listen to verse 53. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels? How then could the scriptures be fulfilled that it must happen thus? He said, Don't you know that I can pray right now and the Father would send 12 legions of angels? Now, let's think about this. One legion is 6,000. So 12 legions would be 72,000 angels. And just to give some perspective, in the days of Hezekiah in 2 Kings 19, we're not going to look there, God sent one angel who killed 185,000 Assyrians in a single night. One angel took care of 185,000. How much damage then could 12 legions, 72,000 angels, do in Jerusalem that night if Yeshua wanted to save himself? Oh, yes, he had power and could have saved himself. Then the next question in my mind as I reflect on this, and since it is my mind, this is how I'm presenting it. The next question is, did Yeshua want to save himself? We know that he could have. Did he actually want to save himself? And the answer is, yes, he did. He did want to save himself. As a man, he did struggle with the innate instinct of self-preservation. It's the strongest instinct there is, you know, self-preservation. That's what his prayer that night in the garden was all about. Matthew 26, verse 37. Three times he prayed about this. Let's read what he said. And this is the human part of Yeshua, verse 37. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. And he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. See, he was emotional. And then he said, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me. He wanted companionship. He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Did he want to be delivered? Yes. Lord, if it's possible, if there's any other way, let it pass. He struggled with it, but then he surrendered and said, not as I will, but as you will. He overcame even the strongest natural instinct of self-preservation and offered himself up. He didn't want to have to do it, but he offered himself willingly and freely, and he did this three times. Yes, on a personal level, and we see the humanity of Yeshua here, he wanted the cup to pass. He wanted to save himself, so to speak, but that was not the central purpose of his life. This is crucial for us. We need to decide what is the central part, the purpose of our lives. He said, yet not as I will, but as you will. Not self-will, not self-preservation, but the will of God. That is the great purpose of our lives. And Yeshua demonstrated, even as a man struggling, he struggled through it in prayer and broke through and offered himself up as that sacrifice. As he prayed, he overcame the temptation to save himself, and he fully surrendered to God's will to offer himself as a sacrifice for sins. You know, and he warned the others. He came back after that first time and they were sleeping. And then in verse 41, he said, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. And what temptation was that? The temptation to save yourself. Self-preservation. We know just hours later, Peter, who had fallen asleep time and time again, entered into that very temptation and said, I don't know him. I'm preserving my life. I'm not going to associate with the one I just spent 3 years with. He fell into that very temptation. You see, it was God's will for Yeshua to suffer. And we think life is all supposed to be all sweet and easy. But you know, in Peter it says, you know, if you suffer by the will of God, do so unto the Lord. There may be a call to suffer and endure hardship. And that could be God's will for your life in that situation. But many of us want to pull away from the cross or from that situation. It was God's will for him to suffer and to die for a greater purpose. And he won the battle in advance in the garden in prayer. And so that day, while he was suffering on the tree of sacrifice, they mocked him and they taunted him. Save yourself. Come down from the cross. He saved others, but he can't save himself. And though he had power to save himself, yet because of his love for us, he remained on that tree of sacrifice. He stayed there. He could have called those legions. He stayed on the cross until he died. And as one great man of God said, it's because he did not come down that we believe in him. Our faith and love for him does not arise from a display of God's power rescuing him from the cross, as men would expect, but rather from the eternal self-sacrificing love of remaining on the cross until he died. That's what wins our hearts. It's love that influences us, not the power of God in rescuing Messiah. But yet there was a great display of power that crowned him Lord. 3 days later, God, in great power, raised him from the dead. That was the display of power, raising him from the dead. In Romans chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, it says, concerning his son, Yeshua the Messiah, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. Listen to this, Romans 1, verse 4. He was declared to be the Son of God with power. How? Not by rescuing him from the cross, but through the resurrection by the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. That was the display of God's power. First, the testimony of self-giving love unto death. That had to be fully surrendered to. Then the great display of power, which confirms it in raising him from the dead. Love is the great motivation. It's the testimony of love followed by the display of God's power in raising Yeshua from the dead. So what does this mean for us who follow him? Well, in the words of Warren Wiersbe, a teacher on the radio, I liked what he said here. Self-preservation is the first law of the physical life, but self-sacrifice is the first law of the spiritual life. Isn't that great? It's so true. Self-preservation in the physical is, you know, we'll fight, you know, either fight or flight, all that. But the first and great law of the spiritual life, self-sacrifice. Yeshua the Messiah calls us to the tree of sacrifice. The world and the flesh will cry out to us, save yourself. Save yourself from that hardship. But Yeshua calls us to give ourselves. The world says, save yourself. Yeshua says, give yourself. Look in Luke chapter 14. Luke 14, verse 25 and 26. What does it mean to follow the one who hung on that tree and stayed there? What is the calling of our Messiah? And great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them in verse 26, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now this is a line in the sand. it's obvious that this is not to be taken literally, okay? Yeshua knew and honored the Ten Commandments. This cannot be understood literally. He means no love, no natural affection in this life must come between us and the Lord. No love in this life can supersede the love and loyalty that we have towards our Messiah. Now that is what Yeshua said. There can be no greater loyalty that we have, even our own life. Yes, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Verse 27. And whoever does not bear his cross or his tree of sacrifice and come after me cannot be my disciple. Now here it is, very clear. These are the parameters of discipleship. He calls us to bear a tree of sacrifice and listen, to stay on that cross. He calls us to stay there. Then he gives two examples of counting the cost of being his disciple. He gives these stories. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish? Lest after he laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. He didn't count the cost in advance. Or what king, intending to make war against another king, does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes with 20,000? Or else, while he's a long way off, he asks for a delegation and so forth. And then verse 33, here's the summary. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. We must at least be willing to forsake all that we have. We must be willing to do that. I want to give an example. Not too long ago, I had the most unusual appointment in my office. A couple, Jewish couple, called on the phone and wanted to make an appointment. Now, I've spoken to many, many Jewish. These were not believers in Messiah. And we sat in my office, and I'm telling you, it was one of the most intelligent interviews I've ever had. This couple came in and had the most intelligent questions, sincerely trying to understand what is this all about. And it went on for quite some time. I was sitting there shocked. I'd never had such sincere, intelligent questions. But towards the end, and they were pretty neutral, they said, well, what about the Jewish community? How will they respond if we consider, you know, Messianic Judaism? And I told them, well, it's likely that you will, you know, there'll be opposition. There will be opposition. I didn't paint a rosy picture. You know, she was counting the cost in advance, and I wanted her to know the cost. This is the cost. You may be rejected by family and friends. You may have hardships as a result of it. But oh, what we gain. Amen. What we gain in Messiah is worth everything. Later, she wrote and called and told me they had decided on a more traditional approach. They counted the cost and were not willing to pay the price. You know, I still pray for them. I pray the Lord would change their hearts because I really liked this couple. I really did. Let me give another example of the tension between self-preservation and self-sacrifice. As you know, we've had a pandemic over the last couple of years. But I want us to compare ourselves a little bit. or at least look at the testimony. This is an article entitled, How Early Believers Saved Lives and Spread the Gospel During Roman Plagues. How did the early believers handle plagues in their days? And I'm reading an article, it's online from PJ Media. It's from the middle of the, it's from March of 2020. So this is, you know, right there. And I'm not going to read all of it, but just some excerpts. Believers facing the coronavirus today would do well to remember how the selfless love of the early believers helped spread the gospel in a world much more hostile to Yeshua's message than our world is today, or at least in the Western world. Biblical faith spread in the face of persecution for many reasons, but in two cases it spread in the midst of deadly plagues because believers risked their lives to save others. I'm just reading, this is the way it was. There were two historic plagues that ravaged the Roman Empire, the Antonine Plague in 165 AD and the Cyprian Plague 249 AD. The plagues killed roughly a quarter to a third of the population. It was devastating. Believers responded to the plagues differently than their pagan neighbors. This one leader recounted the events in Alexandria. At the first onset of the disease, they, or the pagans, pushed the sufferers away and fled even from their dearest, throwing them into the road before they were even dead, and treated unburied corpses as dirt, hoping to avert the spread of it. Yet believers sought to help the sick, even risking their own lives. Heedless of danger, they took charge of the sick, attending to their every need and ministering to them in Messiah. And just to finish here, believers in the second and third centuries lived a counter-cultural lifestyle. They stood out because they refused, number one, to sacrifice to the Roman emperor, and they also saved the children and cared for sick orphans and widows. They lived out the teachings of Yeshua the Messiah in their day. Now, we may not all be called to do what they did, but we are all called to self-sacrifice rather than self-preservation. To the point of verse 33 in Luke 14, verse 33. So likewise, whoever of you who does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Now, to me, that means you got to be willing to do it. He may not ask all of us to sell our properties like they did in Acts, but we need to be willing to go all the way. That's the call. William Barclay, in his commentary, tells the following story. Once someone was talking to a great scholar about a younger man. He said, so-and-so tells me that he was one of your students. The teacher answered devastatingly, he may have attended my lectures, but he was not one of my students. I would not want the Lord to say that about me. I attended services, but I did nothing with it. I didn't do what the master says. Yeshua calls us not to self-preservation, but to self-sacrifice, to the tree, and to stay there until the end. The world will try to lure us away from the tree. Our flesh will try to lure us away. The evil one will try to lure us away. And sometimes carnal believers, through their testimony, will tend to weaken our conviction to hold on to that tree of sacrifice. But remember, Yeshua was pretty blunt when Peter Remember, he said, I'm going to Jerusalem, I'm going to die there. Peter pulled him aside and said, no, Lord, how can you do that? And he looked at the others and he rebuked Peter. He said, get behind me, Satan, for you are a stumbling block to me. For you do not mind the things of God, but the things of men. Wow, what a stinging rebuke. When he was trying to lure him away from the tree of sacrifice. Now, I'd like to close with three practical keys regarding staying on the tree in the midst of a world that shouts, come on off, come on. You don't have to do all that. Number one, Wiersbe is right. Self-sacrifice is the first law of the spiritual life. Yeshua said it right here. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. You may be hearing his messages, but you're not his student unless you're willing to go all the way. We must rank the tree of sacrifice number one daily. I've been endeavoring to do this. I've been praying about it. I guess I'm making a little progress some days, and then, you know, it's kind of like three steps forward, two back, you know. But as we focus on it, God calls us there. He gives us grace to think less, to think of ourselves less. Number two, what I mean by that is that it must be a daily mindset. Okay, it's number one. The cross is the number one thing. So it's got to become a daily mindset, a training mindset. When I recognize that I'm in training, I have a totally different mindset. You know, when you're training for something, you're willing to endure rigor. You're willing to, let's say, eat less. If you're in an athletic company, you're eating less. You're staying lean and preparing for that marathon. I know Fernando, you know, you have a certain mindset, right? It's kind of a rugged, I'm going to run this marathon. I'm training for the marathon. A daily training mindset. And here's the little key. The tree of sacrifice is the daily training course. It's the daily training. This is the course. The tree of sacrifice. He said it here. If you want to follow me, take the tree and follow me. This is the course. Not once when I accepted the Lord, I took the cross, but day by day. The tree of sacrifice at home. How do I act at home? Is it about me and what I want? Or am I taking the tree of sacrifice and being other-minded? The tree of sacrifice at home. How about at work? Taking the tree to work. This is the course of discipleship. To me, this is it. If I had to define a course of discipleship, it's taking the tree of sacrifice in all of life. Carrying the tree, following Messiah. Because only through the tree do we die to the flesh, and then that new creation rises up. The resurrection flows. What about the tree in other relationships? How about as we approach prayer? Oh, I'm too tired to pray. Let me get a bite to eat. Right then and there, take the tree of sacrifice. Right then and there. By the grace of God. What about the tree in sharing the good news of Messiah? Wow. It requires, this is the course. This is how to share. This is how to go into your go list. This is how to give one of our beautiful cards to someone in a restaurant or somewhere. I hope you're giving out cards. Someone shared with me, I think it was Paula, she just gave out a card. How many have given out a card to someone so far? All right. I want to see more hands. Come on, just bring the card. Ask them, hey, do you know what shalom means? Or if they're Jewish, you know what shalom means. Here are some people who really found shalom in the midst of our troubled world. Please pop on here. This is an opportunity, but you need to take the tree of sacrifice to do that. You can't think of how awkward you're going to feel. You can't think about how you might be rejected, how you might get a harsh response. If you think that way, you're not in training. It's only when you're training with the tree of sacrifice that you have the wherewithal to overcome those thoughts and feelings. Amen? Here is the mindset that symbolizes our walk with God. Luke 14, verse 34. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor the dunghill, but men throw it out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. What is the symbol of discipleship? It is salt, my friends, not sugar. Salt, not sugar. Discipleship is a call to salt, not sugar. We are not to pamper our flesh, but to crucify it daily. That's the course. The cross is our daily training course, and it's the only way to follow the Yeshua of the Bible. You can imagine that there's another way. You can create another way in your own mind. But at the end of the day, remember what that scholar said. He may have attended, but he's not one of my students. And we're not to have an auditing mindset where we feel we can hear and not do the homework. This course is for eternal credit. And we've got to do the daily homework, the course of the tree of sacrifice. And the more we do, the more clarity we gain, the more conviction we gain, the more commitment we gain. You see, it works one way. When you drink salt water, you become hungrier and thirstier to satisfy that flesh. But the same is true. The more you drink of God, the more you embrace the cross, the more you gain, the more of Messiah's character is put in you and me, the weight of his character. And we must constantly wrestle, number three, in prayer as Yeshua did. Matthew 26, we know this verse. We've read it already. He said in verse 41, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Why do we constantly exhort one another to have a personal meeting with God every day? For this very reason. It's daily. Watch and pray to bring the power of the flesh under, and we cannot do it ourselves. You know, I want to make a few closing comments here. Had Yeshua come down from the cross to save himself, he would not have died as a sacrifice for our sins. He would not have risen from the dead. There would be no fulfillment of the scriptures and no atonement. He could not have poured out the Holy Spirit 50 days later upon us, and we would be lost. But Yeshua did not come down from that cross, did he? He didn't save himself. He had been saying all along, he's come to give himself a ransom for sin. And we've been persuaded by the fragrance of his sacrificial love, not the force of his power to save himself. And yet again, there was power after the fact. Yeshua did indeed rise from the dead. And Yeshua requires that we take up our cross daily and stay there as he did. It's the first principle of discipleship. It's the training course of discipleship. And we must daily pray to stay that course. In short, our walk with God is characterized by salt, not sugar. Lord, I thank you for this word that you've given us and this call to follow you in a certain way. Lord, you basically said there's only one way to follow you, and that's through the course of the tree of sacrifice. I thank you for this, Lord. Thank you for your grace to do this, your enabling grace to think less of ourselves and to set the will of God as the great purpose of our lives. In Yeshua's name, amen. Why don't we stand and we're going to worship the Lord now. In closing, again, we do have prayer beginning at 1 o'clock p.m. And I know not all of us can say we have children that need to be attended to, but a lot of us can stay today. So the question is, all right, maybe you did make plans. All right. I sent out an email. So I really want to encourage us to take this to heart, the season of seeking him in Yeshua's name. Let's worship the Lord.
Here is my life, I give it all to you, my heart, my soul. My heart, my soul.